mercy.
Lord Jesus, you will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
The name nations you have made shall come and worship you, O Lord, and glorify your name, for you are great and you do wondrous deeds. You alone are God. Lord, you are good and forgiving. You, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in kindness and fidelity. Turn toward me and have pity on me. Give your strength to your servant. Lord, you are good and forgiving.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, the Spirit comes to the aid of our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes with inexpressible groanings. And the one who searches hearts knows what is the intention of the Spirit, because he intercedes with the Holy Ones according to God's will. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Blessed are you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. You have revealed to little ones the mysteries of the kingdom. Alleluia.
That a person took and sowed in a field. It is the smallest of all seeds, yet when full grown, it is the largest of plants. It becomes a large bush, and the birds of the sky come and dwell in its branches. He spoke to them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed with 3 measures of wheat flour until the whole batch was leavened. All these things Jesus spoke to the crowds in parables. He spoke to them only in parables to fulfill what had been said through the prophet. I will open my mouth in parables. I will announce what has lain hidden from the foundation of the world. Then, dismissing the crowd, he went into the house. His disciples approached him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." He said in reply, "He who sows good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed, the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels. Just as weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all who cause others to sin and all evildoers. They will throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears ought to hear." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to the Lord.
I remember hearing that Madison is the 16th largest area in the country for nurseries. Given the climate and so forth, and I'm sure there are many people in this area who have gardens and are familiar with basic principles such as pulling up the weeds. It's interesting that in the garden of God there are many weeds and he doesn't do anything about it. Well, I shouldn't say that. God works in mysterious ways. But what does this mean? The fact that the children of God live in a world which is tainted with evil. And even amongst the children of God, there is a certain amount of corruption. The Lord basically says, leave everything alone until the judgment. There is something to be said for weeds and wheat to be together in the kingdom of God. Now this may sound kind of crazy. How in the world would any garden be benefited by the presence of two opposing entities, between the weeds, between the adversaries? Well, I can give some examples to show that there is wisdom in what God permits. As difficult as it is to take, one example has to do with a young priest who lived several hundred years ago. And his idea was that he was going to live a comfortable life. And this was in the days before priests had salaries that were arranged for them by the diocese. It was a different system where priest salary was based on the income that came into the church or the institution where he performed his ministry. So the young priest was all set to have a very comfortable life, and then something happened that the man who was his roommate, because in those days it wasn't really a rectory, he lived in an apartment with someone else, accused him of a theft, which was a false accusation. To make matters worse, the man who accused the priest defamed him for 6 months. So that's an example of the deleterious effects of weeds, because this priest, though not the most ardent priest, he wasn't bad, and he just said, in time, the truth will come out. Well, eventually it did, he was exonerated, but it changed his life. He became very dedicated to working for God, not simply being somebody who lived a very relaxed life, comfortable existence. And he would become the father or the patron saint of all charitable institutions. He's called St. Vincent de Paul. So the Lord permits good and evil to exist side by side, because sometimes good people are tested, or not even just tested, but they are given an opportunity to grow through the experience, which Vincent did very much. It can happen the other way around. In the altar, right here, on the other side, you can't see it from your side, there's a little opening that's been sealed up. It has the relic of St. Maria Goretti in it, a little chip of her bone. St. Maria died at about the age of 13 in the early part of the 20th century. St. Maria died as a martyr for Christian chastity. A young man who was close to the family tried to violate her. She was resisted, and he ended up stabbing her 14 times. It's a very sad story, except, well, number one, Maria was canonized. Number two, the man, Alexander was his name, went to jail for many years and had a conversion. He had a vision of Maria forgiving him, which she did forgive him as she was dying. She said, "Don't do this, I don't want you to go to hell." He was very concerned about his salvation. The man, because of Maria's witness, changed his life. He ended up working at a Capuchin friary in Italy when he was released from jail. And not only that, but the first thing he did when he was released from jail was he asked Maria's mother for forgiveness. And also, Alexander supplied major testimony at Maria's beatification and was present there. So we see that God works many good things, even in the midst of the ambiguity that characterizes our universe, good and evil. Now, mind you, we're supposed to be children of light, but we know that sometimes it's difficult. We live in a world that can be very, very much in opposition to what we stand for. And many people can let down their guard and become very worldly people. I mean, over the years I have met Catholics who are worldly people. I mean, they may go to church and so forth, not bad people, but their minds are not formed in Christ. They have not really put on the Lord Jesus Christ. They're much more influenced by what the world says and does, things that are in fashion that may very often not be consistent with the gospel. Many, unfortunately, are very materialist in their outlook on life. They don't even know it. They can't see it. But they've allowed the weeds to take hold of them. Now, to make matters even more interesting, we can look at weeds and weed from the point of view of corruption. Weeds corrupt the crop if they're allowed to exist. And we have corruption everywhere. And I'm not saying this paints a dismal picture, but just to be realistic as an observer, we even have corruption in the church. Now, mind you, there was a famous Englishman died, I suppose, about 20 years ago. His name was Malcolm Muggeridge. I would recommend anything he wrote about Jesus or about the faith. But for the longest time, he had some great reservations about becoming a Catholic. He had been an atheist, he had been a communist, and he developed over the years and then became a believer. And he started thinking about Catholicism, but he thought to himself that, no, there's corruption in the church, even among the clergy. So Malcolm Muggeridge, in God's providence, became acquainted with Mother Teresa. And Muggeridge produced the film on Mother Teresa called Something Beautiful for God that came out in 1969. That's what made her famous. Before that time, people knew about her, but she was pretty obscure. So Malcolm Muggeridge, having befriended Mother Teresa, asked Mother Teresa about this question. Well, what do you think, Mother? I'm attracted to the church. I'm afraid to become a Catholic because I see corruption in the church. Mother Teresa said words to the effect that, haven't you ever heard of Judas Iscariot? Meaning, there's really nothing new about that. Even from the very beginning, corruption has been an issue. Judas was the first bad priest, and mind you, he was a hand-picked apostle of Jesus. I would suggest, and you don't have to agree with me here, we have 27 books in the New Testament, which is a fact, but that many of them would never have been written were it not for the fact of dealing with corruption. A couple of small examples. St. Paul in 1 Corinthians 5. You can read this at home. The issue at the time was a man in the church who's not named. He's simply called the incestuous man. And to make matters worse, not only did he have a high profile in the church, it was giving scandal, but the church authorities weren't doing anything about it. So St. Paul was very upset. He was livid. This needs to be taken care of. Furthermore, and there are many possible examples, but another one that comes to mind is St. Paul is given credit for giving us the earliest testimony about the Last Supper. Well, the reason why he talked about it was because he was correcting people who were coming to Mass. Some of them were intoxicated. They weren't taking care of the poor in the collection and so forth. So Paul says to the people, he said, and you can look it up in 1 Corinthians 11, whoever eats and drinks the Eucharist unworthily, he's talking about Holy Communion, eats and drinks the judgment unto himself. Meaning to say, you know, our doctrine of mortal sin, person coming to communion who has committed a mortal sin, who is aware of it, is going to commit a sacrilege. This is what St. Paul was telling the people. So the moral of the story is that the church, from the very beginning, has been tainted. And I don't say this to knock the church. I love the church. But the reason that it's been tainted is because people are people. People are sinners. We're all sinners. And the moral of the story is not simply to be complacent about it. But the true reform starts right in here. each person has to allow himself to be informed and to work on it every day. Because if we don't, we will be weakened by the world, the flesh, the devil, all three things. And we will not contribute to the holiness and beauty of the church. Will the church ever be made perfect? Yes. The church in heaven is perfect. We have one perfect member of the church right now as I speak. The Blessed Virgin Mary is completely intact bodily in heaven. She's come to her total fulfillment. She stands as a sign to the rest of us who have yet completed our pilgrimage to God. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Turn in your missalettes to song number 222.
Good evening, everyone. I know we are all very fond of active communion speakers. However, I will make my message very brief. Give me a few minutes and I will be out of your chair. My name is Alexandria, and I am going to be a junior at the University of Dayton. And this summer, I have been blessed with the opportunity to be an intern with the FEST. For anyone who has not heard of the FEST before, it is an annual Catholic family festival that is held on the grounds of Borromeo Seminary in Wycliffe. And this year, the FEST will be held on August 3rd, the first Sunday, and our theme this year is Chosen. Throughout the day, there will be kids' activities, BMX shows, live music, food, and so much more. On our main stage this year, we're featuring national Christian recording artists, including Third Day, Mandisa, Colton Dixon, For King and Country, and Lee Rossler. If you talk to anyone who has been to the FEST, they will tell you that their favorite part of the day starts at 8 p.m. when the food, activities, and the music shut down, and 38,000 plus people gather together to celebrate Mass outside. It's an amazing way to conclude the evening, and following Mass, there is a huge fireworks display. The FEST is completely free to attend. There is no charge in attendance or participation in anything. So today, I would ask for your help in three ways. First, I ask you to consider volunteering. The FEST is a great day, but it takes over 1,200 volunteers to make this day possible. From helping with children's activities, to greeting people as they enter, to singing in our choir, there is something for everyone to participate in, and you could really use your help. Secondly, we ask for help financially. With your help, we are able to provide a free, fun day for families across the diocese, but we cannot do it without your assistance. Please consider supporting us by purchasing a raffle ticket for a chance to win a new car and more than $60,000 total in prizes, or simply make a donation. Finally, I ask that you join us on Sunday, August 3rd, and invite your family and your friends to come with you. Each year we have people tell us that they wish they would have known about the FEST sooner. So if you know anyone who would enjoy coming on this day, please, please invite them. Thank you so much for your time today. And I hope I can talk with you a little bit after Mass. I will be in the back at a table, and I will be passing out some information as well as selling raffle tickets. And I hope that I will see you on August 3rd and will be able to celebrate Mass with you then. Thank you.
Let's pray. Graciously present to your people, we pray, O Lord, and lead those who have imbued with heavenly mysteries to pass from former ways to newness of life through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Tomorrow is the Knights of Columbus Pancake Breakfast from 8:30 to 1 at their lodge on Route 20 in Geneva. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
Open wide the doors to Christ in your Missalette number 262.